5 seconds. Ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed an honor to address this historic conference and outline our national goals and strategies in the field of basic education. Thanks to the broad vision of our great leaders like Mahatma Gandhi, education was identified as one of the very important sectors through which political, economic, and social progress was sought to be achieved soon after the attainment of freedom in our country, even though the father of the nation was very busy leading the different sections of people of this country in the struggle for freedom. He had evinced keen interest in the evolution of an alternative system of education in tune with the needs and requirements of the Indian society and hopes and aspirations of the people as a whole. As a first step in this direction, the National Planning Committee under the chairmanship of Pandit Nehru had made far-reaching recommendations with a view to make India march forward in the field of education. In order to achieve the goals of bringing down the illiteracy rate and spread of primary education in all parts of the country within the shortest possible time, the framers of the Indian Constitution took care to provide for free and compulsory education for all children up to the age of 14 years. All the same time, successive governments promoted education by all means through 5-year plans, even in these days of rapid progress made in the fields of science and technology all over the world in general and all around the country in particular. There is no reason why people in different parts of the country, especially in rural areas, prefer to send their children to work rather than to school to get basic education. It is needless to say that the very purpose of primary education is to bring about a great change in the living conditions of the vast majority of the people who have been unfortunately continuing to live below the poverty line. The aim of the government today is not only to provide for the good educational facilities to our young boys and girls, but also help them make use of the equal employment opportunities in various public and private sector undertakings. At the same time, one should not lose sight of the fact that we have still a long way to go as far as strengthening the system of primary education and mobilizing the local communities to the cause of basic education are concerned. In this context, it would be interesting to know that in recent times, the experiment of distance education being organized very satisfactorily by various universities in our country has been successful with the masses of urban and rural areas, making the process of learning a pleasant experience for them, and brought into focus another interesting angle of teaching. It is no exaggeration to say that distance education has contributed to some extent to promotion of universalization of primary education for the purpose of reaching out to the millions of people, the national policy on education envisaged non-formal education as an integral part of its strategy to achieve universalization of primary education. It is a matter of great satisfaction that there is an increasing awareness in the minds of the people in our country that education is not necessarily a means to get employment opportunities, but is an effective tool to bring about quality of life of every section of people in society. It is therefore necessary to give credit to primary education sector for all the positive changes that have taken place in the people in matters like health, nutrition, family welfare, child care, social and personal responsibilities, and above all, mental development. During the last few years, it has become necessary to increase allotment of funds in the budget for the primary education sector to make our dream of total literacy come true and face challenges at home and abroad. I would like to state that I have no hesitation in saying that the nation as a whole will come forward to take up the responsibility of providing resource support to achieve the national goal of basic education for all as contemplated in the national policy on education. Letter dated 29th November 1997 to the editor, The Hindu, Chennai. Sir, it is shocking to read the news item, engineering student commits suicide due to ragging in today's newspaper, which should be condemned by one and all. It is a well-known fact that the ragging menace, which was in practice once upon a time in medical and engineering colleges to remove the fear of new students in the new surroundings and help them establish friendly relations with their senior, has assumed alarming dimensions in recent times, making some of the sensitive, bright and intelligent juniors who could not bear suffering any longer and their lives in frustration. It is surprising that the senior students who were once subjected to ragging by their seniors continue to repeat the same mistake, knowing fully well the damage it causes to a new student. There is no doubt that the seniors derive sadistic pleasure by ragging the juniors. Under these circumstances, the government should take necessary steps to make a law as early as possible banning ragging in all educational campuses in the state and to award punishment to the guilty, as has already been done in Kerala. As the personality of a student is developed in educational institutions, it is suggested that the central and state governments should initiate a nationwide debate on this burning problem and ensure that a legislation banning ragging throughout the country and awarding severe punishment is brought about as soon as possible, preferably in the current session of the parliament, to avoid further loss of lives due to this menace. Unless and until the central and the state governments come forward with concrete steps to eradicate this menace, peace will not restore in the educational campuses and in all probability in parents' minds. viewers.